Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Love, Lies, and Hocus Pocus, Legends, by Lydia Sherrer. Narrated by Amy McFadden. Cast of Characters. Main. Lily Singer, introverted wizard, library archivist in Atlanta, Georgia. Sebastian Blackwell, ne'er-do-well professional witch, Lily's best friend. Sir Edgar Allan Kipling, talking cat, Lily's closest companion, Lily is his human. Madam Ethel Barrington, wizard, Lily's mentor, teacher, Sebastian's great-great-aunt. John Faust Le Fay, wizard, Lily's father, plots to revive wizard race and rule mundanes. Lily's family. Alan Le Fay, wizard, John Faust's younger brother, Lily's uncle. Trista, mundane, John Faust's daughter, Lily's half-sister, skilled fighter. Caden, wizard, John Faust's son, Lily's half-brother. Frida Singer, wizard, Lily's mother, formerly Frida Le Fay. Jamie Singer, wizard, untrained, Lily's half-brother by her mundane stepfather. Sebastian's family. George D., wizard, Sebastian's great-grandfather, lives in England. Day Barrington D., mundane, George's wife, Madam Barrington's sister, deceased. Elizabeth D. Blackwell, mundane, George's daughter, Sebastian's grandmother. Stephen Blackwell, wizard, Elizabeth's husband, mysteriously disappeared. Thomas Blackwell, wizard, Sebastian's father, deceased. Allison Blackwell, mundane, Sebastian's mother, deceased. Frederick Blackwell, wizard, untrained, Sebastian's brother. English cast. Nigel Hawkins, mundane, George's manservant, lent to Lily and Sebastian. Helen Pemberton, wizard, Bodleian Library System Administrator at Oxford University. Cyril Hawtrey, wizard, history professor at Oxford University. Emmeline Nichols, mundane, designer and seamstress for her family business. Mary Falconer, mundane, friendly local. Fay. Kaliar, Kaliel, Fay King and Queen, the dualities of growth. Thiriar, Thiriel, Fay King and Queen, the dualities of decay. Uriar, High Fay, a duality of earth, soil. Shariel, High Fay, a duality of plants. Yuki, a duality of the aspect of fox, loves to annoy Sir Kipling. Pip, Low Fay of the aspect of plants, specifically flowers, loves rum. Grimald, Low Fay of the aspect of decay, specifically mold, loves aged pizza. Episode 7, The Calm Before the Storm. Chapter 1, A Hop Across the Pond. Lily sometimes wondered why health insurance didn't cover the cost of cat ownership. It really ought to, since cats were one of the leading contributors to stress reduction and overall happiness in households across the nation. They were 100% natural and had no harmful side effects. Well, if you ignored the hair. She supposed, to be fair, it should cover dog ownership as well. But dogs didn't purr, so they were at a distinct disadvantage in the stress reduction department. At the very least, she thought she should get some sort of premium discount, since Sir Edgar Allan Kipling, her snarky, obstreperous, talking cat, was solely responsible for preventing a variety of health complications over the past 24 hours. Heart attack, anxiety attack, if you do that one more time, I'm going to kill you attack. The therapeutic effect of burying one's face in a fuzzy cat tummy knew no bounds. Not having a heart attack was a good thing, since the fate of wizard kind currently rested on her shoulders. Being a socially awkward introvert didn't help, and she'd long ago admitted she needed all the friends and allies she could get. Which brought her back to the heart attack. It was an understandable concern, considering that her most powerful ally lay near death, afflicted by an unknown curse. Madame Ethel Barrington was Lily's friend, mentor, and instructor in the wizarding arts. Though the woman was more than 100 years old, by Lily's best guess, wizards aged well. She didn't look a day over 70. She'd always been a pillar of wisdom and stability in Lily's life. Now she lay cold and ashen as the grave, and Lily was trying very hard not to panic. Lily sat by her mentor's sickbed in her Uncle Alan LeFay's townhouse, situated in the heart of historic Savannah, Georgia. Though one of the more modest of Savannah's historic homes, it was nonetheless an impressive example of antebellum architecture, with its high ceilings, wood-paneled floors, and plaster walls, complete with crown molding. Madame Barrington's room was clean and well-lit by sunlight streaming in from 4 tall windows, 2 each on the east and north walls. Privacy was preserved thanks to a handy spell that made it appear from the outside as if the curtains were drawn. Alan didn't like mundanes nosing about, and there were plenty in this city full of curious tourists. Despite the sunlight, however, and copious layers of warm blankets, Madame Barrington's hand was still deathly cold as Lily gripped it between both of hers, keeping silent vigil beside the bed. Her heart felt as cold as the hand she clutched, and just as immune to the sunlight. Back aching, limbs stiff, and eyes stinging with weariness, Lily tried not to think too much as she watched the slow, almost imperceptible rise and fall of her mentor's chest. But with nothing else to occupy her thoughts, like iron to a magnet, they inevitably gravitated back toward the cause of this whole mess. Her father, John Faust LeFay. It had been less than 24 hours since their confrontation. Though, to call it a confrontation was a bit of an understatement. If you asked her best friend, Sebastian Blackwell, he would have described it as an epic battle between good and evil. Which was why she rarely let him explain things. He liked to exaggerate. She supposed he deserved a break in this instance, however, since he had gotten his butt soundly kicked by her half-sister, Trista. The young mundane was a veritable expert in armed and unarmed combat, and had unfortunately been brainwashed by their father to help him in his grand plan to save the wizard race and bring about an age of benevolent wizard rule. So, from Sebastian's perspective, she supposed it had been an epic battle. He'd had to use every bit of his fey magic, acquired in a trade, as was the witch's way, along with his own natural wiles to eventually run her off. And that was the other reason Lily preferred to think of it as a confrontation. They hadn't won. Oh, they'd rescued Alan and freed the other wizard children John Faust had been raising as his brainwashed minions. And John Faust had fled, along with Trista and her wizard half-brother, Caden. But they hadn't won. Madame Barrington had been almost killed by one of John Faust's curses, and their adversaries had escaped with knowledge of Morgan Le Fay's location. Morgan was one of the most powerful wizards from the past 2 millennia, and Lily's ancestor. There was no telling what kind of power John Faust might obtain from her, whether she was still alive or not. What with John Faust getting a head start, her mentor being fatally ill, and knowing she had to go to England and fix it all, alone, it was a testament to the power of Sir Kipling's purr that she hadn't lost it already. All right, so not quite alone. Sir Kipling would be coming, and then there was Sebastian. How's she doing? The soft voice behind her made her jump, and she turned to make shushing noises at Sebastian's bright-eyed, boyish face as it poked around the door into Madame Barrington's sick room. Turning back to the bed, she gently released the ice-cold hand she'd been holding and laid it on the covers, trying not to think how like a corpse her mentor looked. It was the blue lips and gray skin that did it, and the fact that her breathing was so shallow it seemed non-existent. To make Madame Barrington more comfortable, Lily had taken down her strict bun and combed out the gray hair to cascade over her shoulders. It was the first time Lily had ever seen the older woman's hair down. It made her look more vulnerable, more human. With a sigh, she moved away, pausing to pet Sir Kipling, currently stationed in a cat loaf on the older woman's chest, where his warmth and purring would do the most good. Then she slipped out of the bedroom, the last room at the end of the hall, giving Sebastian a weary shrug as she quietly answered his question. I can't see any change yet. Alan seems sure his antidote will at least get her conscious, but I can't help worrying. What if she doesn't wake up? I can't bear the thought of leaving before we know she'll be okay. Though she fought to hold it back, moistness formed in the corners of her eyes and threatened to spill down over her cheeks. Hey, it's gonna be fine, Sebastian assured her, giving her shoulder a comforting squeeze, then leaving his hand there. While its warmth was not unwelcome, what she really wanted was to wrap her arms around him and bury her face in his collar. That was out of the question, of course, so she compromised by leaning forward slightly to rest her forehead on his chest and taking deep, slow breaths to calm her emotions. While she was eternally grateful for his friendship and knew she couldn't have gotten this far without him, he did create his own set of problems, though not exactly the ones you'd expect. The fact that he was a witch was a non-issue, even though witches and wizards were traditionally rivals. Being born with magic, wizards tended to distrust and look down on witches for their wheeling and dealing to acquire magic for themselves. But Lily and Sebastian had long since decided to ignore the traditions of their elders. The fact that he was a ne'er-do-well who considered rules to be more like guidelines was, surprisingly, not a major problem either. He had a good heart and always meant well, even if he drove her crazy. No, the biggest problem was that she had finally, sort of, almost admitted that she loved him. She hadn't spoke about it openly, but the fact that she had progressed from denial to semi-acceptance was a huge step for an awkward, controlling, uptight introvert like herself. Of course, the most sensible thing to do would be to ignore her feelings and get on with the task ahead. The problem was, she didn't know if she wanted to be sensible anymore. Staring at the polished wood under her feet, she felt Sebastian's chest rise and fall in a sigh of his own, making her uncomfortably aware of how close they were. Raising her head and stepping back, she turned to stare out the hall window that looked over the busy street below, giving absent, one-word answers to Sebastian's concerned queries. The whole relationship issue was made more complicated by this life-threatening adventure they'd been sucked into, clouding her judgment with worry and fear. Everything depended on her. With Alan recovering from his own injuries while simultaneously nursing Madame Barrington, Lily was the only wizard with the necessary knowledge to track down Morgan Le Fay before John Faust. They might already be too late. Who knew how long it would take them to puzzle out her location from their copy of the ancient journal Morgan had left behind? John Faust, on the other hand, had already discovered her resting place, using a location spell he'd devised. A spell he'd channeled through her Uncle Alan, almost killing him. They'd confronted John Faust too late to stop him using the spell, but at least they'd survived the encounter intact and had deprived her father of his base of operations. The old mental ward he'd been using as a magical laboratory was now an FBI crime scene where Agent Richard Grant, their contact in the agency, was busy leading the investigation against his illegal activities. Not that the FBI knew anything about John Faust's larger plans. They thought he was just some crazy cultist wacko. Lily wished it were that simple. The worst part was, she agreed with her father. Not with his methods, of course. They were deplorable. But his goal to repopulate the wizard race was a noble one, especially since most wizards were in denial about their slow decline and eventual extinction. Even her father's vision of ruling mundane society, putting an end to their petty wars while using magic to make people's lives better, was a laudable goal. Supremacist, racist, arrogant, and wildly idealistic, but still laudable. If her father hadn't been such a miserable excuse for a human being, she might have been tempted to join him. But having already been held captive by him and experimented on herself, she'd thoroughly and irrevocably burned those bridges. Her father was wrong. The ends did not justify the means, and no amount of future good could justify present immorality. Lost in her own dark thoughts, she became aware of Sebastian again only when he gripped her by the shoulders and gave her a gentle shake.
Hey, hey, are you hearing me, Lil? You're gonna be fine. You know why? Because I'm going to help you. And so is Kip, and Alan, and your mom, and everyone else. You're not alone. We'll figure this out together, okay?
Lily took a deep breath and nodded. She opened her mouth to say something bracing that she didn't feel when she heard a weak, halting voice from inside the bedroom.
Hello, Mr. Kipling. I do not suppose you could fetch some water, could you?
Whirling, Lily rushed back into the room with Sebastian close behind. Madame Barrington lay as motionless as ever, but her eyes were half open. Even this simple task seemed to take great effort, but despite her weakness, a ghost of a smile came to her lips as Lily and Sebastian entered her field of vision. Lily gently took her mentor's hand and gripped it tightly. It was still ice cold.
You're awake.
How are you feeling? Lily asked as Sebastian took a cup of water from the bedside table and ever so carefully helped his aunt take a few sips.
As weak as a newborn foal. Alan, is he all right?
Quite a bit better than, well, yourself, I expect, madam.
Alan's wry, reedy voice came from the doorway, and Lily and Sebastian moved back to allow him room to examine his patient. He poked and prodded, muttering things under his breath like,
good, 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 and, what's this now? Interesting.
Finally, he straightened, looking grave.
It appears that the coma was, as I feared, a precipitate of trauma rather than a concomitant of the curse's parameters. While consciousness is a positive development, I fear it does little to illuminate the lexical composition of the curse.
Lily's face fell, and she shot a worried look at Madame Barrington, who had closed her eyes, saving what strength she had.
Okay, could someone translate for the witch in the room?
Sebastian asked, looking back and forth between them. Lily almost smiled, but her cheek muscles felt heavy and stiff. He said that Madame Barrington's coma was a reaction to her physical trauma, like when you get a concussion, rather than magically caused by the curse. So it's good that she's awake, but it doesn't help us figure out the specific wording of John Faust's spell, which is what we'd need to reverse it. We can treat her physical symptoms, but until we get an idea of how the curse was cast, we'll have little chance of breaking it, much less reversing it.
Oh,
Sebastian said, subdued. There was a long silence in which only Sir Kipling's purring was audible.
So, what do we do now?
Sebastian finally asked.
I shall do my best to keep her, well, strength up, while I investigate a cure.
Lily bit her lip, hesitant to appear rude, but absolutely certain Alan would make a terrible nursemaid.
Uncle, I know you'll be terribly busy experimenting and researching, so wouldn't it be helpful to have someone around to care for Madame Barrington?
What? No, not at all. My constructs are perfectly capable of, you know?
He trailed off, looking suddenly uncertain.
I think what Lily meant was, wouldn't it be good to have someone around to keep Aunt B company? Female someone, perhaps?
Sebastian offered, wiggling his eyebrows significantly.
Oh, yes. Yes, of course. I'm afraid I don't exactly... that is, I'm not acquainted with...
There's no need, Lily rushed to say, extremely grateful for Sebastian's diplomatic wording. I'm sure my mother would be happy to help nurse Madame Barrington. Let me call her.
If she can be here by tonight, we can get going tomorrow morning,
Sebastian supplied.
Yes, I suppose, Lily said. The words caused a lump to form in her throat. As desperate as the situation was, she was in no hurry to leave. Here, it was safe. Here, she wasn't expected to fix everything. Yet, she'd always dreamed of going to England. Perhaps it wouldn't be that bad. After all, who said you couldn't enjoy a few rounds of tea and biscuits in the process of saving the world? The conversation with her mother was brief as Lily gave her the condensed version of recent events. Her mother's support was unhesitating. Of course she would come. Anything for dear Ethel. Sally, Lily's oldest stepsister, was perfectly capable of looking after the household while she was gone. Lily gave her mother Alan's address, and Frieda promised she would leave within the hour. Once she hung up, Lily let out a sigh of relief, feeling a weight lift from her shoulders. She knew her beloved mentor would be well taken care of while they were gone to England. With that task out of the way, there were still many things to arrange. She had already called her boss, the library director, and explained how Madame Barrington had fallen ill and that she needed a few personal days to help look after her. That would get her through the weekend. But how was she going to explain needing a multi-week vacation, especially considering she'd already used most of her vacation time? With September already halfway through, the fall term was in full swing and the library needed all of its staff. Could she couch it as a research trip? Perhaps ask for a leave of absence for professional development? Then there was the tiny problem of what to do once they got to England. She'd been avoiding thinking about it, hoping vaguely the whole mess would go away. But of course, it wouldn't. And the longer she delayed, the more time John Faust had to find Morgan. Her first task was to get the names of Madame Barrington's acquaintances at Oxford University. A week ago, had it only been a week? It felt like months. They'd come to Alan's house to find and study Morgan Le Fay's journal, and Madame Barrington had wanted to run John Faust's questionable translation of it past some experts at Oxford. Lily was nervous at the thought of introducing herself to a whole slew of strange wizards, and British ones, no less. What would they think of her? But there was nothing for it. She couldn't let her mentor down. Though she hated to bother her, Lily ducked into Madame Barrington's room and gently shook her awake. Except for a brief break to relieve himself, Sir Kipling hadn't left the old wizard's chest since they'd arrived at Alan's house. So he took this opportunity to slip out and stretch his legs while Lily was there to keep his charge company.
"Hold her hand while I'm gone,"
the feline instructed her.
"Your body heat helps."
Lily gladly did as he asked, cradling her mentor's ice-cold hand in her own as they exchanged quiet words.
"Sorry to wake you, Miss B. I just wanted to let you know Frieda is coming. She'll take care of you while we're gone. I thought she'd make a better nursemaid than Alan."
Lily forced a smile for Madame Barrington's sake, hoping to lift her spirits.
"A relief, I'm sure," Madame Barrington breathed, smiling back feebly.
Lily patted her mentor's hand and continued,
"I have a few questions about, well, our mission. Since you won't be..."
She paused, swallowing. There was a heavy ache in her chest, as if a hand were squeezing her heart to bits, but she forged onward.
"Since you'll be busy getting better, I need to know... well, everything,"
she finished in a rush, trying not to sound desperate.
"What am I supposed to do, Miss B? How am I going to get along in England without you? Where do I start? How do I find Morgan?"
Slow down, dear," Madame Barrington coughed. "You'll be just fine. Use what I have taught you. You are the best student I ever had, you know."
Lily gave a nervous laugh. "Don't be silly. You don't have to lie to make me feel better."
"Not a lie. Good work ethic. Intense focus. Quick learner. You are an accomplished wizard, Lily. Especially for having started so late.
Now she had to choke back tears, scrubbing furiously at her eyes with one hand as she responded, refusing to break down. Nonsense. I'm sure Alan could have run circles around me by the time he was 7 years into his studies. But let's not argue. You need to save your strength. You said you had contacts at Oxford. I suppose it would be best to go there first? My problem is that I'm not sure how to get several weeks off from the library. I've already used most of my vacation. What will I tell the director?
Helen Pemberton. College. Wizard. Used to be Bodleian librarian. Now, library administration.
Madame Barrington's sentences were becoming more fractured as she struggled to speak, pausing between phrases to catch her breath. The older woman attempted to raise her head as if looking for something to write on, but Lily pushed her back. I'll look her up, she promised, scribbling down the name on a piece of paper. Madame Barrington gave a long sigh.
Explain. Ask for temporary. Position, or internship, perhaps. Good friend. She will aid you.
All right. Is there anyone else at Oxford I should contact? Any other wizards? She felt a bit better now that she was taking notes and making plans.
Dr. Cyril Hawtrey took over. Dr. Grootenboer retired.
Lily's ears pricked at the latter name. It sounded familiar. Then she remembered. Her father had mentioned Dr. Grootenboer back when he had told her about his own studies at Oxford. For a moment, her blood ran cold, imagining she would have to meet with old friends of her father's. But then she forced herself to think rationally. Madame Barrington would never send her to seek aid from someone she knew would favor John Faust.
Those two will know others. Guide you,
her mentor continued, voice becoming weaker as she coughed. Lily put down her pencil to help Madame Barrington sip some water. Once she'd drunk her fill, Lily helped her lean back. I'm afraid I've tired you out, dear Ethel, she said, using her mentor's first name in a moment of tenderness. Get some rest. Mother will be here soon, and she makes the best chicken soup you've ever had. You'll be back on your feet in no time. As she tried to rise, however, Madame Barrington clutched her hand, eyes opening very wide as she stared up at her.
One last...
She coughed, then took a deep breath, gathering her strength.
One last thing, Lily. You must contact my sister's husband, George D. He is very powerful and influential, wizard. After I married Arthur, I was struck from the family records and left England. But I kept contact with my sister, Day. George will hear you out. No friend of LeFay's. Explain the situation. We may need his support in the coming days. If I do not recover, go to him for protection. Take Sebastian, his great-grandfather. After all, we'll do it for my sister's sake. Loved her dearly.
Her strength finally running out, she sank back onto her pillow, eyes closed and breathing labored. Lily fought to keep her voice from shaking as she plumped the pillow and tucked her mentor snugly in. Don't talk such nonsense. Of course you'll recover. I'll tell Mr. D you'll come thank him in person as soon as you're feeling up to it, Lily chattered on, filling the air with noise as if that would hold back the fear trying to latch its claws into her. By the time she'd finished and straightened, Madame Barrington had fallen back asleep. Sir Kipling appeared, jumping up on the bed covers and examining them both before curling back up on the old woman's chest.
I hope you got the information you needed, because she won't wake again for a while. She's barely holding on as it is, and needs to save her strength.
He sounded disapproving, as if Lily had been bothering his charge with trivialities.
Oh, shush, pussycat, Lily said, using Madame Barrington's name for him. We all want her to get better. It's not like I asked her to dance a jig.
That's good.
Sir Kipling purred, eyes already half-lidded in either scornful disdain or feline contentment. They were often one and the same.
Jigs are a horrid excuse for something as ancient and noble as dancing. You'd never catch a cat flailing about in such an undignified manner.
An image of Sir Kipling doing the Irish jig popped unbidden into Lily's head. She snorted, failing spectacularly to suppress her mirth as her face split into a wide, genuine smile for the first time in days. Sir Kipling sniffed, nose in the air. Deciding to let things stand as they were, Lily left her cat to look after his patient while she went in search of a landline from which to make an international call, still chuckling as she made her way down the hall. Though it was embarrassing to admit, Lily had never been to an airport before, much less flown on a plane. She'd never needed to. While she'd dreamed of traveling the world, it was done from the comfort and safety of her living room sofa with a nice cup of tea close at hand. As tempting as all those exciting new experiences were, they had the misfortune of being exciting, new, and experiences, all the things Lily tried to avoid. She didn't have anything against excitement or new things, just as long as they kept their distance. She was a creature of habit, and excitement was generally disruptive to her routine. There was a fiery adventurer buried down deep inside of her somewhere, she was sure, but as of yet, she hadn't found it. Thus, it was with great trepidation and not a little bit of stress that she followed Sebastian through the doors of the largest and busiest airport in the world, Atlanta International. Behind her, she pulled a gigantic suitcase packed with every item she might possibly need, and quite a few she wouldn't but wanted with her just in case. In the other hand, she hefted a cat carrier containing one extremely unhappy feline. Sir Kipling had complained long and loudly at the idea of being separated from his mistress and trapped in a small crate for over 9 hours. After all, he'd been able to slip in and out of no pets allowed areas before. Why couldn't he simply sneak onto the plane? Lily didn't even bother arguing. She was taking no chances, not when it involved hurtling through the air in a metal tube thousands of feet above a vast ocean. Now, as she struggled to get her oversized suitcase up to the check-in desk, she tried not to think about how many things could possibly go wrong with said metal tube hurtling through the air thousands of feet above a vast ocean. The fact that, statistically, it was much deadlier to drive a car than to fly on a plane didn't comfort her in the least. They'd had to get up before the crack of dawn to drive back to Atlanta and pack the necessary items from both their houses before heading over to the airport. Plus, they'd had to allow for an extra hour to fill out all the paperwork associated with shipping a pet internationally. To Lily's great relief, there was no special hoops to jump through as long as her pet was microchipped, which, of course, he was. She had rigorously followed all the various vaccination and checkup schedules recommended by her vet in the hope that it would balance out her cat's tendency to do what and go where he pleased. Unsurprisingly, Lily looked around at her fellow travelers with bleary eyes and a frown of general discontent, brain frazzled from too little sleep and too much worry. The fact that Sebastian was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, bouncing on the balls of his feet in excitement, did not improve her mood. "You are disgusting," she grumbled, giving her friend's cheery look a sideways glare.
"Come now, Lily. Where's your sense of adventure?"
"At home. In bed. Asleep."
Sebastian chuckled, drawing odd looks from those around them who, like Lily, knew it was impolite to be happy this early in the morning.
"Why are you so chipper anyway?" she asked. "You hate getting up early, and usually do your best impression of a zombie until at least 11 o'clock.
Sebastian shrugged, giving her a silly grin.
"Just excited, I suppose. I mean, come on, we're having an adventure. Anything could happen. Daring escapes from dastardly villains, life and death struggles with monstrous creatures,
intrepid explorations of wild landscapes never before seen by the eyes of men.
You do realize we're going to England, right?
Lily asked dryly, smiling in spite of herself. England, where the biggest native animal is a deer, and the average mountain is so short they're technically considered hills? This isn't Africa we're talking about, Dr. Jones.
Shush, you're ruining it.
He flapped a hand at her, eyes closed as if to keep his adventure fantasy fixed in his mind.
Just because you're a stick in the mud doesn't mean we all have to be.
Lily was interrupted from replying by the line moving ahead, and she took a moment to wrestle her suitcase a few more feet forward. Just remember your manners, all right?
Please,
she implored him. The British are a very reserved and proper people. They won't look kindly on your usual mucking about. Sebastian grinned a very wide, very impudent grin.
I know. I'm counting on it.
Lily groaned, but was unable to admonish him further because her turn had come up at the ticket counter. With no computer at Alan's house and everything being so rushed, Lily hadn't managed to call ahead to reserve tickets. She simply hoped there was a flight available that morning.
How can I help you, miss?
The attendant asked. We need 2 tickets for the first flight to London. Is there anything available this morning? There was a moment of silence as the attendant checked.
Yes, he said slowly, but the only seats left are first class. Will that be all right?
Lily's heart sank. Her bank account could cover an economy ticket, but there was no way she could swing first class.
Could you check when the next available flight is that has open economy seating, please?
Of course, ma'am.
The attendant typed into his terminal and seemed to take a depressingly long time to find what he was looking for.
It looks like things are quite busy today, ma'am. The next flight with economy available is tomorrow around noon. Will that work?
Her heart sank even further as she desperately searched for a solution. Could they afford to wait another day?
We'll take the first class seats. Thanks.
Sebastian had shouldered his way between the line to stand beside her and now held out a card to the attendant. It had that dirty, sticky look of having been in a wallet for a very long time, yet the edges weren't worn, as if it had never been used.
Of course, sir. May I please have your passports?
Sebastian dug his out. Thankfully, they'd both already had passports, Lily having gotten hers in a fit of optimism when she started college.
Ma'am? Your passport?
The attendant repeated. Lily shook herself, realizing she'd been staring, open-mouthed, at Sebastian, while the attendant looked at her expectantly. Closing her mouth with a snap, she hurriedly handed over the requested document while glaring at her friend.
You have some explaining to do,
she muttered out of the side of her mouth, resisting the urge to demand then and there where he'd gotten so much money.
Later.
He shot back, his chipper look now tinged with discomfort as he smiled politely at the attendant. The check-in procedure went as smoothly as could be expected with all the paperwork they had to navigate regarding Sir Kipling. Once their tickets were issued, they had to go to a special desk to get it taken care of. Before she handed over her cat's carrier, she crouched down to stick her fingers through the door and mutter some parting words.
Just be good, all right? And for heaven's sake, don't leave your crate.
He gave her a baleful stare.
Yes, I know you can get out if you want, but that's not the point. You know how much trouble we could get in if you're caught? Just, please, for me, okay?
She wiggled her fingers invitingly. After a moment of disgruntled glaring, he gave in and pressed up against the door of the carrier, accepting her affectionate rub behind the ears with reserved dignity.
Fine, but I'd better get some of this famous clotted cream you keep going on about.
Lily grinned. I promise you will. Now, be good and stay safe. I'll see you in 9 hours. With a pang, she watched as they carried her companion away. Despite her best effort, the long list of things she was trying and failing not to worry about had just gotten longer. They got through security without a hitch, though there was a bit of a fuss over a large silver coin Sebastian forgot to take out of his pocket.
Lily recognized it as the one he liked to play with, rolling it over his fingers. He'd been taking it out less and less these days. In fact, she hadn't seen him messing with it since she'd noticed, and pointed out, that it was covered with Dimmu runes. It was probably some heirloom from his family, and she was beginning to suspect it did something magical, but had no idea what, since he wouldn't let her examine it. So many secrets. He was full of them, and every day that passed, she discovered more. Speaking of secrets, now, would you mind explaining what that was back there? Lily asked, with barely suppressed impatience, as they chose seats in the waiting area for their gate. I kept my mouth shut when we paid Anton that ridiculous sum to get in touch with Tina, but this is too much. I won't be part of anything illegal. She tried to keep the huff out of her voice, aware that her usual reaction to his rule-bending, outraged indignation, was not as mature as it had once seemed.
What makes you think I'm doing anything illegal?
He responded coolly. Lily couldn't tell if he was upset or simply trying to deflect her question.
Well, you live in a junk heap apartment in a sleazy part of town and drive a car that belongs in a scrapyard. I honestly don't know how you get by. For you to suddenly have thousands of dollars in spare change seems, well, suspicious.
She looked away, embarrassed and hoping he wasn't insulted by her words. It was a valid question. There was a long silence in which she didn't dare look at him. When she did finally glance up, she was surprised to see an expression of weary sadness. Far from glaring at her in outrage, his eyes were distant, as if focused on a faded memory.
Sebastian?
She touched him lightly on the back of his hand, worried. At her touch, he visibly shook himself, eyes returning to the present, though he didn't meet her gaze.
I get by on my own blood and sweat. Being a professional witch isn't lucrative, but it pays the bills, and that's all I need. All I want. I don't take anything I haven't earned.
His tone was defiant, yet his words conveyed vulnerability, not his usual brash confidence. Lily gulped, unsure what to say. This was a Sebastian she'd rarely seen. Charming, teasing, roguish Sebastian she knew how to deal with. But this? Hesitating, she laid her hand on his, jumping a little when he twitched, perhaps in surprise at her boldness. Ignoring the blush this caused, she said quietly,
I believe you,
and left it at that. She wanted to say more, to demand answers, but she didn't. Hopefully he would volunteer them on his own. Sebastian sighed into the silence between them, the soft noise barely audible over the bustle of the Atlanta airport, even this early in the morning.
When our parents died, they left Freddie and me rather, large sums of money. Mr. Perfect used his almost right away to invest and start a business before he even finished college. He's done quite well with it, of course.
A flash of something, perhaps envy or disgust, accompanied his words.
Mine got put in a trust. I haven't touched it since.
Until recently? Lily prodded gently.
Well, yeah.
Silence again. Lily was fine with that, since her head was too full of thoughts to sort them out into words anyway. She'd always assumed Sebastian's parents had been relatively middle class, at least for a wizard family, and that Madame Barrington's fortunes were unrelated, since she'd come directly from Old English stock. She'd never before known the particulars of her mentor's relationship to her friend, beyond, of course, that she was his aunt of several generations. But now, knowing he was George D's great-grandson, she'd done a bit of research last night on the name. And, while he was no noble, his list of accolades was so long you could have cut it up and sewn it into a suit. Much of it was decades old, of course. She'd noticed that once wizards passed the normal, mundane age of retirement, they did their best to fade into the background and not make a fuss about the fact that they appeared distinctly impervious to age.
But of all the people who mattered, she was sure there were still many quiet, unspoken connections that lasted long after the public limelight had faded. Though it had made her squirm inwardly, she'd also done some research on the Barringtons. She'd resisted before now out of respect for her mentor's privacy. But if she was going to travel abroad and attempt to make allies out of foreign wizards, she'd better know the lay of the land. Surprisingly, or perhaps not, she could find no information about an Ethel Barrington. This would make sense if she had, indeed, been disowned after her marriage to a commoner, and a mundane, no less. Lily had more luck with the sister's name, Day Barrington, at the time of her death, Day D. Day was the only recorded daughter of Miles Reginald Barrington, 10th Viscount Barrington of Aylesborough, one of the many variations of the city name Aylesbury. Though Lily had no idea if Day had been a wizard, she suspected the marriage between her and George D. had been more about magical lineage than titles and property. If George D. was as powerful as Madame Barrington had implied, even a wizard of great property and title would be anxious to ally with him, despite his lack of noble peerage. Because of English peerage laws, upon Miles's death, the title of Viscount had gone to his closest male relative, a cousin, rather than pass on to Day. But still, her inheritance would have been substantial. Lily hadn't been able to learn any more than that in the brief time she'd had, so she was eager, if rather nervous, about meeting George D. and getting the full story. She wondered if Sebastian had ever met his great-grandfather, or even knew who he was. With his father's anti-magic attitude, it seemed unlikely they would have maintained strong ties with the wizard side of the family.
I couldn't use it.
Lily almost missed the words, they were so quiet. Distracted, trying to corral her wandering thoughts, she gave Sebastian's hand an absent-minded pat to show, well, something. Solidarity, perhaps? Only then did she realize her hand was still there, resting on his. She thought about withdrawing it, purpose achieved, but before she could decide, Sebastian turned his own hand over and laced his fingers through hers. After that, she didn't have the heart to pull away.
It would be like admitting they were gone. Like, I would rather have the money than have them back. It's ridiculous, I know.
No, it's not. Lily still didn't know what to say, so just said whatever came to her. It was a thrilling and terrifying experience. Even though they left the money to you, it still feels like theirs. And if you use the money, it becomes yours, and that would erase their memory from it. Sort of like that watch you showed me once, the one your dad gave to you. You never wear it, right? Maybe because if you wore it, it wouldn't feel like your dad's watch anymore, and you'd lose that small part of him. One of the few you have left. She trailed off, hoping she'd said the right thing. Judging from how tightly Sebastian gripped her hand, she thought she had. Her next question was hesitant, since she wasn't sure if it was prying too deep, but at least it might get them off the topic of his dead parents. So why did you finally decide to use it?
Because you needed me.
Lily sat, stunned, not sure how to take that answer.
It was for you, not me. And Mom and Dad would have liked that.
He finally looked up at her. Face full of pain, but eyes softened by a hesitant hopefulness. No words came to her, and obviously her brain had stopped working a while ago. So instead, she just smiled and squeezed back. It was enough. They did not, in fact, see Sir Kipling 9 hours later. Unbeknownst to them, it took several hours to process animals shipped internationally, so they had quite a bit of downtime before they could make their way to the Heathrow Animal Reception Center. At the Hark, after presenting all their paperwork and receipts, they were finally presented with one surprisingly content feline. Lily waited until they were outside before grilling her pet, having expected to find him in high dudgeon after hours of confinement.
"Well," he said,
I was rather grumpy when the plane arrived. There was a dog in the hold with me, you see, and it would not cease its yapping. But the lovely lady who took care of me was very appreciative of my natural handsomeness and grace. She gave me milk and salmon, if you would believe. Couldn't keep her hands off me.
Lily eyed her cat's self-satisfied expression, unable to stop her lips from curling into a smile, despite his obvious implication that she was derelict for her inferior food offerings. Well, I'm glad you're in a good mood, because you'll have to stay on your carrier for now. I'm sure they won't allow loose pets on the bus.
That wiped the smug expression right off his face, and he settled down into a disgruntled ball of fluff inside his carrier, refusing to speak to her further. That was all right. He would perk up once they found a hotel and he could roam free again. They'd decided not to spend the night in London, but rather go straight to Oxford and book a hotel. They had a meeting with Helen Pemberton at 9 on Monday, and so had all of tomorrow to settle in and track down George D. It would just be easier to go straight to Oxford and use it as their staging point, rather than try to navigate London's crowded streets. Of course, Oxford's labyrinth and alleys wouldn't be much better. Lily had seen the maps and was very glad neither of them had bothered to get an international driver's license. But at least they would only have to book into one hotel. It took some tricky navigation through various shuttles, but they finally found their way to Heathrow Central Bus Station. By this time, it was past midnight, though to Lily it felt about 8 o'clock. Even so, she was dead tired from getting up so early and took a quick nap, leaning against Sebastian's shoulder as they waited for the bus. The bus to Oxford only came about every 2 hours this late, or early, in the day, so they had quite a wait. By the time it arrived, Sebastian had to shake her awake, and she followed him blearily on board, letting him take care of the necessary exchange of monies while she found a seat to accommodate them, their luggage, and their unhappy feline. The trip took barely an hour and a half, giving Lily plenty of time to be disappointed at missing the beautiful English countryside they were passing through, now cloaked in darkness. She'd been surprised at how balmy things felt when they'd exited the airport. They'd come prepared for any eventuality of weather, something she'd read was a must in England. It was most definitely chilly, requiring a long skirt and light jacket, clothing she would be sweating in at this time of year in Atlanta. But it was a far cry from the blast of freezing rain she'd been led to expect on any given day in England. Well, except perhaps in July. Other than that, all bets were off. When they finally arrived at Gloucester Green in the center of Oxford City, they were stumbling with weariness and clueless as to where they might find a pet-friendly hotel. It took them nearly 20 minutes to find the taxi rack, which was hidden one street over between a row of shops, rather than directly next to the bus station. It was deserted at this time of night. Well, morning. Fortunately, Lily had possessed the foresight to purchase them both prepaid phones at the airport, and they were able to call a taxi without much delay. Sebastian took the driver's recommendation of a hotel, and they were dropped off at the McDonald Randolph. Had Lily been fully awake, she would have protested the choice, since it was a 5-star hotel and entirely more expensive than they needed. But at this point, Sebastian was steering the ship, and she simply followed along, lugging her oversized suitcase and carrier full of cat. She was awake enough to notice Sebastian's hesitation when the lady at the front desk tried to put them in one room. But it was only for a moment. Then he smiled politely and said that, no, they would require separate rooms with a pet-friendly one for the miss. At last, at long, long last, Lily dragged herself into her hotel room. She had only enough energy to free Sir Kipling from his carrier and set out food and water and a litter pan before collapsing onto the bed, fully clothed and fully unconscious. Chapter 2. The Most Honorable House of Barrington. It was well past noon on Sunday before she felt alive enough to get up. The first thing she saw was Sir Kipling sitting on the windowsill, watching the street outside with some interest. "What is it?" Lily asked blearily, rubbing sleep from her eyes.
"We're in England, right?"
her cat asked. Yes? Why?
Because it looks like downtown Beijing out there. There's so many Asians. And they're all waving these strange sticks around above their heads. I can't tell if they're angry or if it's some sort of mating ritual. England certainly is an odd place.
Confused but curious, Lily stumbled out of bed and joined Sir Kipling at the window. He hadn't been exaggerating. The street was thronging with life. And, yes, most of them appeared to be Asian. She laughed. Those are tour groups, silly. See all the tour guides waving their umbrellas and shouting? And the sticks are to help the tourists take pictures with their cell phones.
I see,
he muttered, tail twitching thoughtfully.
I suppose I expected there to be more, well, Englishmen in England.
Lily's smile was interrupted by a yawn, and she stretched, trying to get the kinks out of her back. I'm sure it will calm down during the week. But remember, this is Oxford. It's home to one of the most internationally famous universities in the world. I'm sure there are thousands of students and scholars here from every country imaginable. Now, why don't you make yourself useful and go wake Sebastian up? We need to get to Aylesbury as soon as possible. In response to her request, Sir Kipling lifted a paw and started washing between his toes. Lily rolled her eyes, looking around for her prepaid phone. She wanted to call Alan to see how Madame Barrington was doing. The phone was in her hand, number half dialed, before she remembered that Atlanta was 5 hours behind. She would check in later. Putting the phone down, she headed for the bathroom and a much-needed shower. When she emerged, wrapped in a towel and ready to get dressed, Sir Kipling was gone. Lily smiled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.